I want to go now to Gabriel Sterling. Now, you all know Gabriel well. He's a lifelong Republican. He was Georgia's voting system manager, became a household name when he stood up to President Trump's lies about election fraud in Georgia. He's now the CFO and COO for the Georgia Secretary of State. Gabe, I really appreciate your time. So, Congresswoman Green, who, you know, as I pointed out, you know, is on tape saying there's no evidence for a plane flying into the Pentagon, is now an elected member of Congress, you know, says the election was stolen, and she's now on this committee. She has, you know, harassed you on Twitter. She called you a moron, an idiot, little Gabriel, because she blamed you for the loss of the Georgia Senate seats and Trump's loss there as well. I mean, Gabe, how concerned are you about people like her gaining such prominence in your party?
Well, she's duly elected by the people of the 14th district, so they have her for 2 years, and there are primaries that can happen, and I think her continued behavior may invite a primary, and she may well hold on to that. I mean, that's the will of the voters. That's what's going to happen. But we need to have, I feel, for Leader McCarthy trying to hold a caucus together like this that has Marjorie Taylor Greene on one side just sending out wacko stuff, but she gets encouraged because she gets literally thousands of donations from across the country when she says the wackier stuff she says, the more it's fallen into. And Liz Cheney, on the other side, trying to be responsible and do some of these things. I don't know if I would have voted the same way as Liz Cheney did, but she has every right to do it. I mean, Leader McCarthy said this caused this. Leader McConnell said that, you know, the crowd was inspired by Trump's lies, or lies that were fed to them. He didn't say Trump's lies, but I think we all know what he was talking about. We need to get to a point of where everybody kind of gets into a responsible phase, and the president remains angry. And the real issue you have is there's millions of Republican voters who are Trump voters, yeah, who believe, because they want to believe in their heart, that it was stolen from them, and they can't process that it wasn't.
Right. Now, of course, they only believe that because he told that to them, and it was amplified, as McConnell said, by people in positions of power. By the way, that includes McConnell himself, who took 5 weeks to formally acknowledge Joe Biden was the president-elect. But on this issue of Kevin McCarthy, right, he says, his office says Marjorie Taylor Greene's comments are deeply disturbing, that he plans to have a conversation with her. Obviously, as far as we know at this point yet, he hasn't. You know, you mentioned the donations and the money, but I'm curious, Gabe, as you speak as a lifelong Republican who's disgusted by this stuff, as a lot of Republicans are, why do you think party leaders are kowtowing to this, are scared of people like Congresswoman Green and QAnon?
Well, the reality is Trump and this strong base of populists that they have can hurt the party. What one side cannot win without the other side in most districts in this country, and definitely in most Senate statewide elections. So for years, there's always been sort of a governing group and sort of a populist group, and they interchange sometimes of what they believe and what they focus on. You can't win one without the other. You know, there's far left Looney Tunes people out there that are part of the Democrat Party now with different kind of conspiracy theories, you know, who are part of that coalition too. But this particular one right now is being led by the person who was formerly the president of the United States. And I think presidents, and I've said this numerous times, should be held to a higher standard and should be more conscious of the things they say that can undermine democracy.
Right. And of course, you know, he was, I mean, I'm going to say he was perfectly conscious of what he was doing when he was undermining democracy. But this brings me to the point about him and his role.
Yeah. They need to be aware that it's wrong. So that's where the disconnect is.
Right. So, but McCarthy's going to Florida tomorrow to kiss the ring of Trump, even now, even though he's no longer in office. And, you know, this may be part of the reason why. Let me just play McCarthy after the riot happened. He called it like it was. And then let me play what happened.
The president bears responsibility for Wednesday's attack on Congress by mob rioters.
Do you believe that former President Trump provoked?
I don't believe he provoked if you listen to what he said at the rally.
I also think everybody across this country has some responsibility.
So what do you think happened there? I mean, he completely backed off.
Well, I think it's like many elected officials, you can say things that and try to get the nuance of it to get by, but he's, like I said, he has an unenviable job of trying to lead a caucus that is very divided right now between, listen, there's a lot of these Republicans who know that this election wasn't stolen. There's a lot of them that know the president's lied about this. There's a lot of them that want to go back and tell their constituents, we're doing something to give you confidence back in this. And they're trying to get their legs under them. January 6th with a wake-up call, and I think it really let a lot of air out of the balloon of the conspiracy side of it. So there's people out there who are normal, everyday Americans who are believing some of this stuff, but then they're like, this is what it leads to. This is a little nutty. So I still think with time, some of the air will get let out of this balloon, and people will get back to rational, regular governing. The problem we have is we are so polarized, and the president plays on that. He enjoys that, and he has a strong voice that's a base still within this party. Like I said, I think over time, some of that will change, but we can't, as Republicans, get in a position where we totally disregard one side and then never win election again and Democrats win everything. That's not something that is a smart thing to do politically. And this worshiping at the altar of no compromise and owning the libs is unproductive in the long run.
No, well, certainly it is. I mean, I just want to, you know, remind everyone, Gabe, as you're saying now, you know, you had no fear all the way through of saying these things were lies. So I just want to make a point that that can be done by Republicans, because it was done by some Republicans, including you. And you actually, a moment I remember, and I think many of our viewers probably remember well, when you went on national television and you said this.
Mr. President, stop inspiring people to commit potential acts of violence. Someone's going to get hurt. Someone's going to get shot. Someone's going to get killed.
You said that on December 1st. So then there were people killed, right? People killed at the Capitol. The Department of Homeland Security now is issuing a threat due to the ongoing potential violence, saying a domestic extremist could be emboldened by what happened at the Capitol. So you said it was going to happen, and then it happened. People died.
This is the worst case scenario I had in my head. When I was talking about it originally, you could see that happening, but then you think, there's no way that happens, and then it happened. I hate being right. I'm disgusted that I was right. We have to get back to a place where we can have disagreements, but that the other side is not going to set you on fire. That's true for Republicans on the far right and Democrats on the far left that believe the other side is essentially evil. And they get fed into, and I think COVID has fed into this because we dehumanize people because we were not around people as much anymore. Mm-hmm. And algorithms on Facebook and Twitter do the same thing where we only listen to the people we want to listen to, and we never get opposing views or humanize those people. People are allowed to disagree. And we used to have a really good job of doing that in this country. We had the best system in the world for it, and we still do. All the institutions are there, but we're only as strong as the individuals within it. It never occurred to Secretary Raffensperger and I not to follow the law and do the right thing.
Right. So I just want to be clear here. The soundbite that I played, of course, was based on the things the president was saying, and you said what could happen, and then, of course, it did. That's at the heart of the entire impeachment trial, right, was whether the word echo we heard of what he said and what they said, whether he bears responsibility, right, which McConnell has said he does, and, well, McCarthy said he did until he didn't. So you're actually mentioned by name in the supporting documents for the impeachment article. I don't know if you're aware of this, but everyone watching should be aware. Yeah, you are, and your exact comments are there, exactly what I just played. And President Trump had every reason to know that, incited by his statements, the thousands of people pouring into D.C. would engage in actual violence. As early as December 1st, elected officials warned President Trump of the consequences of his rhetoric. That is, and then they have your exact quote. Would you be willing to be a witness at the impeachment trial?
I have zero desire to go to D.C. to be part of anything. I've got a job down here in Georgia that I have to do. But of course, if, you know, it comes to that, I don't know if I have a choice in the matter. In fact, no one's even talked to me about that, so I haven't really contemplated it.
All right. Well, now you know you're in those documents, the supporting documents to the article itself. You're there, Gabe. All right. Well, I appreciate your time. Thank you very much, as always.